Security. Been in a number of different vertical markets, higher ed, energy, and at the moment I am with COTA, so security for the bus system, transportation services, has some interesting challenges in that business. So, but ironically, this talk is about something that I did at a previous job and not with COTA. I've got a different set of problems there. So, but we're going to talk about PKI and certificates. So, see here, we get this moving. Come on. Advance. There we go. Public key infrastructure, digital certificates, certificate authorities. What do they give us? They give us all the things that we expect in this world, the great CIA, authentication, confidentiality, integrity, and interestingly enough, non-repudiation when we get into digital signatures. Through this talk, by the way, I'm going to assume a certain level of knowledge with digital certificates, digital signatures. It's supposed to be a technical talk. At some level it will be, but you always got to try and strike a balance. So if there are questions afterwards, please ask. In addition to the good things that digital certificates give us, they've given us Heartbleed, Drown, Superfish, another great one out there, and of course a variety of man-in-the-middle attacks. So digital certificates have their good and their bad. And by the way, I'm not trying to pick on Lenovo because Dell also released a certificate on their computers that allowed for a lot of phishing. So it's not limited to one manufacturer, but that was a really cool logo that Gawker did. So what do we use certificates for out there in the business? Primarily, secure data transfer over the wire. You have a whole bunch of different protocols, TLS, SSL, HTTPS, your VPNs, secure FTP, and we just kind of count on, you know, when we do an assessment or when we're checking off the boxes on compliance, yes, my over-the-wire stuff is encrypted. Good. We're safe. In addition to over-the-wire, code signing, if your business develops code and software, it can be used for legal documents, origination, validation, and again, like I said earlier, the non-repudiation. So there are many applications for digital certificates within most business environments. And we see digital certificates in everything, all kinds of electronics, from thermostats and computers to appliances today. We'll talk about appliance failures in a minute. Electrical outlets, the new things, and for us, even a COTA. I've got digital certificates on buses for communications purposes and various other things. So they're everywhere. They're throughout our environments in our work, day-to-day work. And you know, what are we doing with them? At the beginning, we have certificate authorities. Ultimately, we really have to kind of count on them. They're the trust. They're the broker. They're kind of like the notary out there in the world where you buy a certificate, it's issued to your company, there is supposed to be validation that you are who you say you are, and then they attribute to that trust so that someone around the other side of the planet can know who your business is. And those things happen from certificate authorities. They're auditable. You can follow up on it. They offer revocation and renewal services. We'll talk a little bit about those problems. The problem is that there's a lot of businesses out there. There's a lot of use of digital certificates. And so big certificate authorities, then there's intermediate certificate authorities that have a layer of trust up to the top. And at the very bottom, you can even issue them within your own organization. Your Microsoft Active Directory environment, you can issue self-signed digital certificates. And we'll talk a little bit about what those mean in your environment and what the importance of those are. And those self-signed certificates come back to that whole Superfish thing. And we'll talk about that. I'm just laying some groundwork here. Level set, so to speak. Certificates are internet glue. They're everywhere. They're on your wireless systems. They're on the networks. They're in mobile devices. They're in embedded devices. Ah, we're going to have some more of that today. Good. And code signing. And again, that really comes down to your business and whether or not you're doing that. But if you are, we're going to talk a little bit about the risks of that. Trusted root certificates. And here's a whole interesting topic. You may not realize, but your mobile phone, your browser, your computer at your desk, they all have a large certificate store on them. Root certificates. Because you're not always connected to the net. And so you can't validate a certificate every moment. And there's different root stores, so you don't know what's in them. What certificates have been placed there? We're counting on Microsoft or Google to ensure that those certificate stores are appropriate, validated, and secure. And I'd venture to guess most of us don't know what's in a lot of those root stores. As an example, this was some screenshots I did for this talk from my mobile phone. And I've got just your basic Android, nothing special. And if you look in there, this is just a little segment of all the dozens and dozens, several hundred root certificates on my phone. You got to love some of the generic names. Government Root Certificate Authority. Who's that? As it turns out, it's the government of Taiwan. If you look at the certificate. But it's not always obvious. I mean, some are obvious. And we can guess about some, like the Hellenic Academy is probably a Greek certificate. But we don't know. We don't know what all's out there. As a matter of fact, Google not too long ago banished a certificate from China. CNNIC. My phone, I have it turned off. I had to go in and do that. Now, if you look in the Chrome browser, the CNNIC certificate is gone. And interestingly enough, when I did a sampling of devices, my Kindle Fire didn't have it, so Amazon's cool. But how many of us have checked that on our systems? We probably haven't. Little range thing here. Signed certificates, self-signed certificates. Mentioned this. We all use them in our businesses. They're all over. They're used in the development shop sometimes. You don't generally put them in public places, but within a business, they're all over the place. They can be on your VPNs because, hey, I just need a certificate to do the digital encryption. I don't have to have a big, fancy, expensive certificate from an authority. But in your business, who's authorizing those digital certificates? Do they really have the permission of your company to issue it? How recently? Can you tell if it's been revoked or if there's a problem with it? How long is it valid? One of my favorite things, you look at self-signed certificates and you'll see them out there and they'll have a life of like 2050. Okay. Gee, you want to vouch for that in about 10 more years? And how good is it? Here's the thing that most people don't realize about self-signed certificates and why they're kind of dangerous. A self-signed certificate contains both the public and the private side of the key. They're in both. Both are there, which means that if I steal that certificate and I can guess or find out the password, I now have your certificate to use as my certificate. And that's not a good thing. We'll see that here when we get into the vulnerabilities and threats. As an example of that, the vendor failure, going back to Superfish. That's exactly what happened with Lenovo and with Dell. They had put self-signed company certificates onto the laptops that they shipped out. And, of course, a few people that are looking under the hood found those. And using some tools, they extracted the public and private key segments. And then, digging a little further in some of their code on the system and using simple little commands like strings, they find sequences of alphanumerics that look good, and then you just start trying them. And guess what? They crack the certificate. And now, you've got an interesting problem. Now, these self-signed browsers that we use internally. How many of you have seen something like this from Firefox or the Google one that says, oh, gee, you know, I don't know about that certificate. I can't validate it. Do you really want to do it? Do you want to add it to the safe list? Okay. What are we teaching our users? We tell them not to click on links in email, not to download unusual attachments. Oh, no, but it's okay. Just click on that certificate and go on. This is something we have got to stop doing to our users. It's an awareness problem, and it's not good for what we're teaching them. We're teaching them bad habits, and we don't need to teach them bad habits. They've got enough of those. So this is something, what you can do, and there are ways around this. I mean, you can set up a certificate for your business that all your self-signed certificates come from, a root certificate for your business. Put that on your company laptops. They won't see this. It's a fixable problem, and we're not fixing it because it's quick, it's easy, and we roll it out. Okay, so what are these bad things with certificates? We've talked about how we're using them, where they are, and I've alluded to some of the problems. Well, the first problem is, and we've all heard about these, certificate authorities, as great as they are, do get compromised. DigiNotar's gone. That was the Dutch certificate authority. They're gone. They couldn't even audit that to figure out what hadn't been stolen from them. Komodo has had breaches. I mean, it doesn't matter who you go with. There's a risk for that, and you have to be cognizant of that risk. In 2014, a large intermediate CA in India got compromised. And the same thing. Now you've got all these certificates out there. They've been revoked. They're not good. You can't trust them. So now you can't trust your communications over the wire or whatever you're using it for. So that's one problem. Real problem is what happens when one of those big root certificates gets revoked? How many things under it break? And are we prepared for that? Do we have a plan in our business when Google revokes a 20-year-old VeriSign certificate? I mean, there were some businesses that noticed that. A lot of them didn't, depending on what you were doing. But again, one of these days it's going to be something even bigger than that one, and that was big. And then last but not least, we have implementation errors. And I'm going to break these down a little bit here in a few minutes that cause things like Heartbleed and more recently Drown, which we just heard about in the last few months. And what is that? So there's theft, implementation errors, and we're not done. There's more bad. Where's my gunning goat there? Some of the algorithms are vulnerable. Certificates done with MD5 and SHA-1, which are now both considered vulnerable algorithms. We really shouldn't be using, generating, or really accepting certificates with those. There is now malware out there that is actively stealing digital certificates and also inserting and replacing certificates into the stores and into the browsers and other places. And we need to be looking for that stuff. And last but not least, as if the technical problems aren't bad enough for us, we make our own mistakes. We do the Lenovo thing. A self-signed certificate gets into production. Or we promote it somewhere. Or just letting your certificate expire. How many of you have had your website go with the HTTPS red bang? Oh my gosh, we can't connect securely because you forgot to renew your certificate. Microsoft pulled that one. 2013, the whole Azure service. Some of us noticed that. That's a problem. So real attacks on certificates. Things that have happened. Began a number of years ago with Stuxnet. We got that nice code. I say we. Okay, officially, maybe it wasn't us. We all know. We got code into the Iranian nuclear facilities, messed up a few of their centrifuges, signed code, signed with what appeared to be a completely legitimate certificate. More recently, there's one out there. You know, Google some of these if they're interesting later, and my presentation will be available. Operation Amental has been going on. It's not clear who's behind it, but there is a big effort to place fake certificates in some businesses. We have seen malware comes from HTTPS sites, not just your bare HTTP sites. And it makes phishing very interesting. I mean, when we're teaching those people, our users, you know, watch the site you're going to, watch the links you're clicking on, they feel pretty comfortable about going to an HTTPS site. We've taught them a little bit. But they're making those phishing sites because they're using stolen certificates or otherwise what appear to be good certificates. Poodle. What I refer to as protocol attacks. For those, kind of digress here for a second, and there'll be a little more on it, but when your browser connects,
hi folks, Alan Geek here. We have several technical glitches throughout this entire talk where audio cut out, and there's a point where the video really throws towards the end of it. So sorry for all the problems. In a little bit you'll hear audio again, and then it'll continue, and then it'll stop, and all we'll have is the slides for a bit. Sorry about the technical difficulties.
We have certificate compromise, which can involve CA failures.
Hello?
Hey. Which can involve the CA failures, losses, things like that. And, of course, the malware that is stealing or placing certificates. The certificate insertion. Vulnerable algorithms, which... You know, those of us that look at this, we enjoy that problem. We like to talk about how the probability of breaking SHA-1 or that, but that's really a minor problem besides some of these other things. The implementation issues really bite us in the rear, and the process errors. So we've got, when you think about the digital certificates in the environment, we've got a ton of problems. And I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but I will freely admit.
you have none. And by the same token, same reasoning, avoid just redirecting HTTPS.
Because again, it's a man in the middle path for that. Let's see.
Hello.
Hey. Okay. We're just going to keep trying it on and off. We'll see how it goes. Yeah. Does this. Well, there is some, we're going to talk about something coming up here. There's a new RFC out there, and there's a protocol now called HSTS, which enforces end-to-end encryption. And we'll talk a little bit about that, but there are some problems with it. So there are solutions. I'm not just throwing out problems to give us all gray, more gray hair than I've got. Yeah, there is something for that one, although the HSTS has its issues too. Use those wildcard certificates carefully. The ones that star.coda.com, where you can have subdomains. And the reason for that is that if you lose that certificate or it's compromised, then all those sites are compromised potentially. And there's also been some cases where the bad guys have actually bootstrapped onto the side of that and created xyz.business.com, and it looked legitimate and it wasn't. Review. How many of you have actually looked or run a test on your web servers for your business and checked the TLS protocol negotiation? And there are websites out there that do this. A few of you have. And what you know, you'll find out, are you vulnerable to drown or heartbleed? Are you allowing SHA-1? And you can actually fix that. Come on. HSTS, there you go. I'll come back to HSTS. And also certificate pinning. We're going to talk about each of these. So back to wildcard certificates. Here's some places not to use them. Don't use them on your login page. Don't use login.coda.com. That page should be its own certificate. If you're doing an e-commerce site, don't make it part of a star domain. Make that its own certificate. There are places you can use it, maybe help desk support, things like that. But watch out. Try to avoid it on login, sensitive data, and e-commerce. Those sites should be isolated and on their own certificates. Because, again, a certificate compromise will mean numerous pages are burned. And as an example of how that can be misused, the Malaysian police portal wound up hosting, inadvertently, PayPal.com, where they advertised you could go and fix parking tickets and so on. And guess what? It was a phishing site. So, yes, and that was done with a wildcard certificate. That some of these links, like I said, they'll be in the presentation. You can download so you can go follow up on the story. They're kind of amusing and scary at the same time. TLS selection on your web server. So select a cipher. There's various tools out there for this. Different web products offer different settings. But you do want to take a gander at those and make sure that they're set appropriately and that you're not allowing. How many times do we tell people, change the default passwords, change the default this and that, right? We set up a web server, do we change the default settings? We're not very good about some of these things. We practice what we preach. Okay, back to what you were asking about, HSTS. So the whole thing about the man in the middle at the beginning or at the negotiation point, they've started a RFC 6797. It's an extension to HTTPS called HSTS, Strict Transport Security. And it will help with SSL stripping, TLS downgrade attacks like Drown or those. It makes man in the middle a lot harder, not impossible. It will protect your cookie-based web credentials. It has a number of advantages. There is one problem. The very first connection to an HSTS site can be impinged because of the way the protocol works. So what has happened is Google is actually doing it, and what they've done is, you don't know it, but in your Chrome browser,